Good evening. My name is Sonny Doubleday, and tonight I will be telling you a very condensed story about a group of immigrants who decided to accept the challenge of walking 2,200 miles to a new life in California. This entire group, totaling 91, will be forever known as the Donner Party. Due to the extremely large number of members in this particular group, I will forego the monotonous procedure of listing them all by name, age, and individual demise. That information will be shown at the close of the many slides in this presentation. Instead, let's get right into it. On April 16, 1846, 9 brand new covered wagons rattled slowly out of Springfield, Illinois, and headed west. The Donners and the Reeds made a lavish entourage. 32 men, women, and children in all, counting the Reeds, 2 hired servants, and the 7 Teamsters who had answered George Donner's ad to drive the big wagons. However, the most extravagant luxury was the Reeds family wagon, a 2-story affair with a built-in iron stove, spring cushion seats, and bunks for sleeping. It took 8 oxen to pull the mammoth ark that 12-year-old Virginia Reed called the Pioneer Palace Car. No one had ever seen anything like it. Except for the Reeds, families did not all board up in a wagon for an effortless ride through the countryside. Most families walked alongside the wagon, which would be filled with all the supplies you would need between stopping points and a single driver. A guide printed at the time called Provisions for the Trail listed some of these items as follows. The recommended amount of food to take per adult was 150 pounds of flour, 20 pounds of cornmeal, 50 pounds of bacon, 40 pounds of sugar, 10 pounds of coffee, 15 pounds of dried fruit, 5 pounds of salt, 1/2 pound of saleratus, which is a mix of baking soda and baking powder for leavening, 2 pounds of tea, 5 pounds of rice, and 15 pounds of beans. These provisions were kept in watertight containers or barrels to minimize spoilage. The usual meal for breakfast, lunch, and dinner along the trail was bacon, beans, and coffee, with biscuits or bread. Now remember to include all your cooking and eating utensils, clothing, multiple pairs of boots, bedding, guns, ammo, and knives for hunting and protection, shovels and tools for repairs, plus all the extra bridles and harnesses needed for the livestock. Suffice to say, the wagons were full. Their immediate destination was Independence, Missouri, the main jumping-off point for the Oregon and California trails. Once beyond Independence, however, they were stepping off into the unknown. All they knew was that the long and dangerous journey would take them 2,200 miles across the huge windswept plains, mountain ranges, and scorching deserts. Time was everything. The grueling journey couldn't begin until the spring rains had subsided and had to be over before the snow blocked the Sierra Nevada mountains. The same day the Donners and Reeds rolled west out of Springfield, Lansford Hastings prepared to head east from California to see what the shortcut he was promoting was really like. He'd heard that you could go south of the lake. The idea was to depart just before you got to Fort Bridger, going through the mountain range south of the lake, across the salt desert through the Rubies into California. The problem was, he himself had never really done it. June 27th. Already behind schedule after many rain delays, the Donners and the Reeds reached Fort Laramie. There, James Reed found an old friend from Illinois named James Kleiman, an old mountain man who had just come east from California using the Hastings Cutoff. Reed, anxious to make up for lost time, asked Kleiman what he thought of the cutoff. Kleiman told him of the great desert and the roughness of the Sierras, and that the straight route might turn out to be impractical. He told him to take the regular wagon track and never leave it. However, Reed wouldn't be swayed. July 18th, they crossed the Continental Divide, 1,000 miles from Independence, with more than 1,000 miles to go. 2 days later, the wagon train reached the Little Sandy River. It was the parting of the ways. Most of the immigrants heeded Kleiman's warning and turned right, but 20 wagons, including the 9 belonging to the Donners and the Reeds, turned left towards Fort Bridger and the entrance to Hastings Cutoff. When they arrived 1 week later, Hastings wasn't there. He had started west a week earlier, leaving instructions for any immigrants who wished to follow along behind. They spent 4 days resting their oxen and making repairs. August 6th, at the bottom of Echo Canyon, the party found a note from Lansford Hastings. It stated that the road ahead was virtually impassable and advised them to wait until he could show them a better way. James Reed spent 5 days finding Hastings. When he did, the promoter refused to come back to lead the company himself, pointing out what he thought might be a more manageable route from a high peak. The next day, the party turned off the track into the wilderness. August 22nd, the remaining members of the Donner Party spilled out of the mountains, exhausted and shaken, with 600 miles still to go. They hurried on, following the track of the Hastings wagons, until they found the tattered remnants of yet another note. It read, 2 days, 2 nights, hard driving, across desert, reach water. On the third day, the water ran out. That night, crazed from thirst, the Reed's oxen bolted into the desert and could not be found. The family took what belongings they could carry and started out. The next day, the immigrants stumbled out of the salt desert. It had been a disaster. It had taken them 5 days to cross the 80-mile desert Hastings had assured them was only half as wide. Several immigrants had almost died of thirst. 36 oxen were lost. Wagons would have to be abandoned, the Reed's Pioneer Palace car among them. Someone would have to ride ahead to California and bring back relief. A Missouri farmer named William McCutcheon and Charles Stanton from New York volunteered. Finally, on September 26th, the Donner Party reached the Humboldt River, where the shortcut rejoined the old trail. Hastings' cutoff had proved not only more treacherous than the older route, it was only 9 miles shorter by my calculations. James Reed stabbed another driver on October 5th over mistreating some oxen. A German immigrant named Louis Kesseberg demanded that Reed be hanged for it. When Margaret Reed begged for mercy, the company chose banishment instead. Indians ended up killing 21 oxen with poisoned arrows, laughing at them along their plight. The company had now lost more than 100 head of cattle. October 19th, their food was nearly all gone when Charles Stanton finally returned from Sutter's Fort with 7 mules loaded with food, 2 Indian guides, and news that the high pass of the Sierra wouldn't be blocked by snow for at least another month. The immigrants' hopes rose. They were going to make it after all. They camped for 5 days, 50 miles from the summit, resting their oxen for the final push. On October 31st, the front axle of George Donner's family wagon broke. Cutting timber for a new one, George gashed his hand, and the family fell further behind. The rest of the party kept going. That night, they camped 1,000 feet from beneath the summit, waiting for the Donner wagons to catch up. The Donners did not come. During the night, it began to snow. The next morning, the party headed for the pass, but 5 feet had already fallen higher up, and the wagons began to slip on the steep, rocky ascent. The pass was completely blocked. They had lost their race against Mother Nature by 1 day, only 150 miles from safety, at Sutter's Fort in California. They retraced their steps to the lake and started building a winter camp. The remaining 81 members of the Donner Party, 25 men, 15 women, and 41 children, including 6 nursing infants, were now huddled miserably in 2 makeshift winter camps. 6 miles away on Alder Creek, the 2 Donner families huddled in tents where the storm had caught them. They began to mix what little meat remained with anything they could chew and swallow, including boiled hides, charred bones, twigs, bark, and leaves. In mid-December, 15 of the strongest immigrants resolved to make another attempt to break out. Franklin Graves fashioned crude horseshoes from oxbows and rawhide. On the 16th, when William Eddy and the Indian Lewis and Salvador in the lead, they started out for the summit. They took 6 days starvation rations each. They called themselves the Forlorn Hope. By the 9th day out, they were lost in the California mountains. They had been 3 days without food of any kind. The suggestion was made that were one to die, the rest might live. Then the suggestion was made that lots be cast, and whoever drew the longest slip should be the sacrifice. The slips of paper were prepared, and Patrick Dolan drew the fatal slip. No one had the heart to kill him. William Eddy got his dying companions to sit together in a ring and pulled blankets over them. A canopy of snow quickly covered the starving group. First, Antonio, a Mexican teamster, died. Franklin Graves was next. He died in the arms of his daughters, Mary and Sarah. Patrick Dolan went insane and had to be held down by his companions before slipping into a coma and dying himself. William Eddy crawled out of the white tomb where the dead and dying immigrants lay and managed to relight the fire. Someone cut the flesh from the arms and legs of Patrick Dolan. They roasted the meat and ate it, while the two Indians, Lewis and Salvador, refused to eat. The 10 surviving members of the Forlorn Hope butchered what remained of their 4 dead friends, wrapped and carefully labeled the pieces so that no one had to eat their kin, and pushed on. 3 days later, there was again nothing left to eat. William Foster proposed murdering the Indians for food. William Eddy tried to talk him out of it, then told Lewis and Salvador of the white man's plan. The Indians stood disbelieving for a moment and then silently disappeared into the snowy woods. At sunset on January 17th, William Eddy made his way back to camp. He told Sarah Fosdick, who had already watched her husband die, and his heart roasting on a stick, of the bloody footprints that led them to where the Indians, Lewis and Salvador, were, and how William Foster, insane, shot each of the men through the head, and how the starving survivors used the murdered men for food. February 19, 1847, 7 men of the first relief party struggled over the summit and came within sight of the lake. The rescuers were shocked by what they found. 12 immigrants had died and bodies were laying everywhere on top of the snow, covered with quilts. 48 still clung to life, but some had gone mad and others were too far gone to be revived. Somehow Margaret Reed had managed to keep all of her children alive. So had Peggy Breen and Tamsin Donner. So far, none of the survivors at the lake had been forced to eat any human flesh. There was no time to waste. The rescuers could take only 24 of the starving immigrants out with them. The Breens agreed to wait for the next relief party. So did the Donners. George was too sick to move, and Tamsin would not leave his side. On February 22nd, the first relief party started back. There was almost no food to spare for the 31 people left behind. On February 24th, Patrick Breen wrote in his diary, "Thursday 25th, froze hard last night. Fine sun shining today, wind west. Mrs. Murphy says the wolves are about to dig up the dead bodies at her shanty. The nights are too cold to watch them. We hear them howl. Friday the 26th, froze hard last night. Today, clear and warm wind, southeast blowing briskly. Martha's jaw swells with the toothache. Hungry times in camp. Playing hides, but the folks will not eat them. We will eat them with a tolerable good appetite. Thanks be to Almighty God. Amen. Mrs. Murphy said here yesterday that thought she would commence on Milt and eat him. I don't that she has done so yet. It is distressing. The Donners told the California folks that they commenced to eat the dead people 4 days ago if they did not succeed that day or next in finding their cattle, then under 10 or 12 feet of snow, and did not know the spot or near it. I suppose they have done so by this time." For 2 more months, 4 relief parties battled the terrible snow and cold of the Sierra Nevada to try and save the starving immigrants. The scenes enacted in the mountains during those 2 months would never be forgotten. When James Reed and the second relief party reached the lake, Patty and Thomas were still alive. The rest of the camp was a shambles. 10 more immigrants had died, and the survivors had begun to eat the dead. The fiercest storm of the winter broke over the second relief party as they struggled to cross the mountains. For 2 days, the immigrants and rescuers huddled around a fire that sank slowly into the snow. It was there that the third party found them 10 days later. When the third relief party reached the lake, only 7 immigrants remained alive. Tamsin Donner was among them, still remarkably strong for all she'd been through. George, who was dying, begged her to leave. Tamsin refused. She would not let her husband die alone. The fourth relief party was delayed 1 full month by the 9th and final blizzard of what was the worst winter ever recorded in the Sierra Nevada mountains. They found Lewis Kesseberg in his cabin, delirious, surrounded by half-eaten dead. No one else was alive. Tamsin Donner's body was never found, and Kesseberg confessed to eating her remains. On April 21st, the last relief party left the lake. On April 25th, they reached Bear Valley. It had been 1 year almost to the day since the Donners and the Reeds had left their homes in Springfield, Illinois. Of the 91 men, women, and children involved in the Donner Party, 46 survived, 41 died, 5 women, 14 children, and 22 men, counting John Sutter's Indians, Lewis and Salvador, who had risked their lives to save the immigrants. Of all the families, the Donners suffered the most. All 4 adults and 4 of the children died. All of the Reeds survived, so did the Breens. Almost a century later, trees the immigrants had shorn off at snow level still stood as a vivid reminder of the fierce winter of 1846.
Let the body slip and blow. Let the body.